Dear friends, greetings from Kiev to all the IPB family, and thanks to organizer for important webinar on this sad occasion of the second anniversary of Putin's criminal assault against Ukraine. It is a rare event today where people gathered to discuss how to stop the war, not how to destroy the enemy. It is clear that the war is planned and budgeted for many years. People are told that the fight for survival will require sacrifices and being prepared for the worst scenarios. But people also have a right to peace, and people have a right to move towards peace, breaking the ice of fears, lies, and hatred. Peace movement is a part of human nature. It is indispensable, incorruptible, and omnipresent. It starts from listening to the voice of conscience in every sane mind. At the Munich Security Conference, President Zelensky said, "Do not ask Ukraine when the war will end. Ask yourself, why is Putin still able to continue it?" He also talked about his invention, the Ukrainian peace formula, which assumes that all sorts of security, from national to environmental, to food and nuclear, should be ensured by a united war effort of the whole democratic world to provide Ukraine weapons and defeat Russia. Of course, we in the peace movement have a peace formula of another sort. Peace is not equal to war. Zelensky's commitment to democracy, declared in his peace formula, is commendable, and blame towards Russia for aggression, of course, justified. But his formula is a bit incomplete, because any war or any other sort of systemic violence is incompatible with real democracy. Political power of inclusive, peaceful dialogue, decision making, and nonviolent life. It is a dangerous utopia to turn the whole nation into soldiers and wipe all the enemy nation out from the planet. And the fact that the enemy nation attacked you first don't make this delusion legitimate, though, of course, we all understand right to self-defense, I think preferably by nonviolent means. Putin is still able to continue aggression because of militarist utopia entrenched in popular superstitions worldwide, not only among his subjects and fellow dictators, but also among his rivals. I remind you that the European Court for Human Rights in 2020 allowed Putin to conscript people contrary to their conscientious objections in the case Diaghilev versus Russia. And it was a sad day of moral failure for European democracy and rule of law. Putin is able to attack Ukraine because his sovereign right to oppress and to conscript his subjects is not challenged, denied or prohibited by international law, because he is allowed to play by the rules of militarist playbook, which is on the table everywhere today, because nationalism, militarism, and great power ambitions to control their spheres of influence became normal in international affairs. The East, notably Russia and China, and the West, including Ukraine as its part, can't achieve real security by forcing their people to fight and ignoring credible security concerns of each other and refusing to have fair and principled discussion. Peace movements are needed in democratic society precisely to remind that real peace means that people are talking instead of killing, when the people are united not to fight against the common enemy, but to work for common good. People united not to fight, but to work for common good, for peace. That peace means not killing all enemies, making even more enemies to yourself in the process until they kill you. But peace in reality means turning enemies into friends, or at least good neighbors, as it happened many times in history, and it must happen again. But you should be cautious when talking about peace and common sense to haters. I am already prosecuted, my home raided with seizure of computer and smartphone for advocating peace and conscientious objection to military service, criticizing demonized enemy image, and suggesting that tragic mistakes were made on both sides. My pacifism was considered a thought crime. There is a ideologically biased forensic linguistic conclusion, which among ignorant attacks on a pacifist worldview nonsensically claims that anti-war statement clearly condemning Russian aggression and any other war is a crime, supposedly it justifies the war. Despite two independent experts found no justification of Russian aggression in my words, by the way, published on the website of International Peace Bureau, I still could be charged in this crime punishable by 5 years of prison. 5 years! These political repressions under laughable pretext have obvious ulterior purpose to shut down peace and human rights activism of Ukrainian pacifist movement, because the militarists hate when we talk about nonviolent resistance, when we help a prisoner of conscience, Vitaly Alexeyenko, to complain and get release through the Supreme Court, when our member Andriy Vyshnevetsky sue President Zelensky demanding discharge from army on the grounds of conscience, when our peace agenda for Ukraine and the world becomes a nonviolent alternative to Zelensky's peace formula. But despite all the hate and repressions, I am determined to remind the militarists that censoring pro-peace speech is not a defense of democracy, but it is authoritarian tendency. That abducting people on the streets, ignoring their objections, not only based on conscience, but even based on health, and treating them inhumanely in military training camps, like they did in recent scandalous case of Sergei Grishin, conscripted despite his serious illness and denied of proper medical examination, who was forced to declare hunger strike, and now he is in coma because of violent attempts to make him a soldier. All of these are menaces to the component of democracy in Zelensky's peace formula. And a recent bill aimed at total military registration under threat of civil death, without exceptions to objectors, with particular purpose to force Ukrainians abroad to return and fight, or else they will be deprived of property and consular services, also is not a democratic move. Since Ukraine wants to join the European family, European governments must insist on proper legal recognition of human right to conscientious objection to military service in Ukraine. They must also provide asylum and protection for all those who can't return home because of credible threat of repressions for advocacy of peace and the right to refuse to kill. And this threat is obviously credible in Russia, Belarus, and sadly even in Ukraine. Since governments are reluctant to comply with their human rights obligations, the Object War campaign was launched and it needs support of civil society. When whole world prepares for war, pacifists prepare for peace, as we always do. Someone need to do it seriously. Instead of self-fulfilling fear of big war, we bear in hearts and minds a self-fulfilling hope for a big changes in politics and economies, minimizing to a near zero level manifestations of violence in social life and governance, abolishing all wars, armies, weapons, and arms industries. Don't ask us how to defeat the enemy. Ask yourself, are you prepared to work for a better future without enemies, where the word enemy will be forgotten? Sorry for I've been late to conclude. I'm just from meeting of Ukrainian pacifist movement, where after heated debates we adopted the statement with reading of which I want to conclude. It is a statement on participation of unarmed pacifist forces in implementation of the Ukrainian peace formula. Ukrainian pacifist movement, bearing in mind the formula that peace is not equal to war, supports and will implement in our activities the values of peace, democracy, and justice declared in the Ukrainian peace formula of President Zelensky. We agree with condemnation of Russian aggression, demands of withdrawal of troops, and compensations for damages. Nobody could feel safe while the war is considered normal and dictates its rules of lawlessness. We will act on the basis of belief that democratic society and democratic world must be united for common good and common security. We will resist nonviolently to Russian aggression and all forms of militarism and war. We will support preservation and development of democracy. We will protect human rights and rule of law. Pacifism is a vital part of diversity of thoughts and beliefs in the democratic society. We will preserve pacifist identity, which gives hope for a better future without wars, and we will uphold our right to refuse to kill. This is the statement and the last word. When I'm talking about nonviolent resistance, I understand it is very complicated concept. Explaining it to people, I even say that hiding in shelter is also a method of nonviolent resistance. Truth telling, spreading of hope instead of hopelessness, lies, threats, and so on. Reason, truth, love, conscience are ways to resist the darkness of war. And we must understand that Russian aggression, it is dark itself, but also it evoke dark parts of our hearts here in Ukraine. So to resist the darkness of Russian aggression, we also need to resist darkness of some instincts here at home. Resistance to darkness at home is part of preserving light and resisting to worldwide darkness brought by Russian aggression. Thank you.